What's up, guys? I got a brand new video for you today. Today we're looking at the X-T30, and I want to thank Fujifilm for sending this out to me to review for you guys. I've had it for almost a month now. I shot with it in LA, I shot with it here in Toronto, and as you know, most of my reviews come from a portrait photography background because that's what I do. I'm a portrait photographer, and so that's how I'm going to review this camera. Obviously, I think Fuji has aimed this camera more at travel and just a small compact camera to have on you, but because of the fact that it basically is 75% of what the X-T3 can do, this camera can be a great portrait photography camera as well. So jumping right into the specs, if you didn't know already, this has the 26 megapixel X-Trans 4 backside illuminated sensor. It's an APS-C sensor, so the same one that's in the X-T3 right now. It has a base ISO of 160, so that's down a little lower from the 200 in the X-T20. It has 425 phase detect autofocus points across the entire sensor. It has a 2.36 million dot EVF. It has a 3-inch tilting screen here, which is 1 million dot. It's also a touch screen. Now this camera can do 8 frames per second mechanical shooting. It can also do 20 frames per second and 30 frames per second, kind of like the X-T3. The only thing is there's a slight crop, and because of the buffer size on this camera, it can't crank out a ton of shots at once. I think it cranked out about 26 shots before the buffer was filled. You can shoot up to 1/4,000th of a second on the mechanical shutter and all the way up to 32,000 on the electronic shutter. It has a single SD card slot as well as a 2.5 millimeter microphone input and a USB Type-C and micro HDMI. Now the cool thing with this camera is you can actually charge it through USB-C, but you can also get a dongle that's a USB-C to headphone adapter and plug your headphones in this to monitor audio. It uses the same NP126S battery that pretty much all the current Fuji cameras are using, but keep in mind that this camera does not come with a charger, so you're gonna have to pick one of those up. Otherwise, you have to charge it inside of the camera. All right, so those are the main physical features and the main specs of this camera. The thing I find interesting is the video specs, so let's get into those. This camera can shoot DCI or UHD 4K video up to 30 frames per second at 200 megabits, which is really cool. It can also do 1080p 120 frames per second, and that's also at 200 megabits per second. Now there is a limitation when shooting video with this camera, probably due to the form factor. It's just small, it's harder to dissipate heat. So when you're shooting 4K video, you can only do up to 10 minutes before it's gonna stop and restart. And in 1080p, you can do up to 15 minutes before it's gonna stop and you have to restart it. Now here's a crazy thing that kind of blew my mind, especially for a camera in this price range, is that you can actually record 10-bit 422 out through the HDMI. So if you have a recorder like the Atomos Ninja 5, I did some tests, I'll show you those later, but you can actually record some pretty high quality video out of this thing. I just listed off all those specs, and you know, the price is crazy. It's $899, and for what this camera can do, it's literally like 75% of what the X-T3 is. This little camera has some serious horsepower, and I'm pretty sure that Fuji has kind of aimed this camera towards more of a high-end travel camera just because of its build quality and features, but it's also a really good beginner's camera as well. And one of the things that make me think that is that there is an actual auto switch right on the top. So obviously you have all the buttons and dials, you can do everything manually, but if you want to hand this off to like your grandma or your aunt or someone that doesn't know how to use a camera, you can actually switch the switch on the top. It goes to full auto, does full auto autofocus, it'll even do face detection and things like that, and completely control your exposure and get you the best image. So like I said, I've shot with this camera quite a bit, even since I did my first hands-on quick look with this camera. I wasn't surprised with the image quality coming off this camera because it's the same as the X-T3, the exact same sensor, and so it's everything that I would expect it to be. When it comes to low light performance, it's again identical to the X-T3, it's the same sensor, the same processor, so I'm not going to cover low light performance with this camera. If you want to look at something like that, you can actually check out my X-T3 review, and I think I covered that there. The main thing I want to cover, the biggest thing, the biggest feature, the biggest upgrade, whatever you want to call it, to this camera is definitely the autofocus system. Now the X-T3 will probably get the exact same autofocus firmware that this camera has, but up to this point, this camera actually is way snappier, way more responsive than the X-T3 in my opinion, but obviously once the firmware comes out, then that's going to change things and they'll probably be exactly the same. Now, the only thing I really want to mention on is when it comes to high-speed continuous shooting and tracking with this camera, so you're doing like face detection or whatever, obviously there's no blackout at aim frames per second, but what you'll see is the UI or the box that they draw for the face detection area is actually super laggy and way behind the actual person's face. And it kind of makes you feel uneasy because you're like, well, this doesn't look like it's in focus at all. But if you go back and look at the images, it's actually fine. Now, I didn't shoot a ton of video with this camera, but I did notice that if you're shooting slow motion, like 120 frames per second at 200 megabits, this camera actually has some really good slow motion. I would say it's even better than the X-H1 and the X-T2. And I think that's just because it has a higher bit rates and no pixel binning and things like that. They've also included the Eterna picture profile, which I love to shoot in. It's kind of like a flat cinematic look. It's easy to grade if you even want to grade it. And this camera will also do F-log. So if you want to shoot full log with this thing and get the most dynamic range out of it, you can do that as well. And lastly, before I move on, I want to show you guys what the 10-bit 422 looks like in Premiere. I just want to show you the kind of dynamic range you can pull out of it. And yeah, let's check that out now. Okay, so I have a project loaded up here, and this is the Moza Air 2 unboxing video. I shot this all with the X-T30, recording into the Atomos Ninja 5, and it's recording 10-bit, 4K, 422. What I've noticed is that I can actually push the footage pretty far, and I kind of want to show you here just kind of live grading what you can do with this thing. And obviously, this looks great, and it's running really well. It's ProRes, so it runs really good on a Mac. And I want to go to a shot, something like this, where there's some shadows, some highlights, and things like that. I'm going to turn off the color grading layer. I'm going to just add a live grade to this so you guys can see what it looks like. I'm going to go in here and adjust my scopes here so I can bring my blacks down. Actually, before I bring the blacks down, I want to show you how much shadow detail we can pull up. So this is something that, you know, 8-bit footage would start to fall apart. Obviously, this is an 8-bit video. It's also through YouTube, and it's hard to really tell. But on here, you can see so much shadow detail being pulled out of here, and it's not going all blocky and grainy. But I'm going to color grade this and bring the shadows down because we don't really need them being pulled out at this point. It'll lift the exposure a bit, warm it up a little bit. There's not much you need to do to F-log. It's really easy to grade. Just add some saturation here. Add a little bit more contrast. So obviously, this looks pretty good right out of the box here. I don't really need to do too much to it. And yeah, that's basically it. I think that if you were shooting something like a short film, this camera would actually be pretty good recording into the Atomos Ninja 5. I also want to mention that while I was reviewing this camera, Fuji actually updated the app. It's called Camera Remote now. And it's not that the old app was terrible or anything. I mean, obviously it wasn't great, but this app is quite a bit better. It's a lot more streamlined. It looks nicer. The UI is easier to use. Connects to the camera pretty much every single time. No issues there. And I found that the refresh rate between the camera and the phone, there's like hardly any lag, and it actually looks like 60 frames per second. Sometimes it skips here and there, but it's actually pretty good. But the thing that I was disappointed on is that if you've ever used the app in the past, most of these cameras, when you're shooting 4K, it just won't do it through the app. It shoots like 720p. And I noticed that it's still kind of like that. It'll only shoot 1080p. So if you're trying to use the app to monitor yourself, you're not going to be able to record 4K video with this camera. I have fat, chunky hands. And for someone that has hands like this, this camera just feels too cramped. And I don't know, it's maybe not for me. It's obviously meant for maybe people with smaller hands. I did find that my hand would hit the Q button back here. I'm not a huge fan of the placement of the quick menu button. It's kind of in the thumb grip area, and I found that my palm was hitting it all the time, and I was always in the quick menu and I didn't want to be. I do love the new layout on the back. It doesn't have a D-pad at all. You actually just have the joystick, the menu button, and the display and back button, and you use the joystick to kind of navigate the menus and also move around your focus point. So it's kind of a different look. I like how clean and streamlined it is, and it actually works. The last gripe I have about this camera is when you're shooting video, it does break up your video into 4 GB chunks, and I'm not sure if they're gonna fix that with firmware like they did with X-T3. It's kind of annoying when you're shooting with this thing and you've got like a million clips you gotta bring in just for one clip that you're using. This camera has awesome tactile buttons, just like all Fuji cameras. It's built out of metal. It isn't weather sealed, but you know, this thing's built like a tank. It has great intuitive menus. I love the Fuji menus. And again, it has a spec sheet and a bunch of features that not too many cameras can match this for the same price. This thing kind of just does it all. If you're thinking about picking up this camera, I'll put links down below where you can find that and maybe some starter lenses with it. Right now I have the 18-55 on it, and this lens is actually awesome. It's kind of a kit lens. You can also get the 15-40, but I would recommend this lens over that one. This lens is really good. Once again, I want to thank Fujifilm for sending me out a loaner camera so I could review for you guys. And that's it. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. If you dislike this video, give it a thumbs down twice. Don't forget to hit that notification bell, and I'll see you guys in the next one. All right. I think we got it.